Hello all, welcome to the 6th byte in the EMV video series. In this video, I'm going to talk about issuer scripting, one of the less used but a powerful feature available in EMV cards. So this video is organized into two chapters. In the first chapter, we will look at what is EMV scripting. In the second chapter, we'll look at how does it work. So let's jump to the first chapter. In case of MaxStripe cards, once the issuer issues the card to the cardholder, the issuer does not have an opportunity to update the data on the magnetic stripe. Whereas in case of EMV cards, the issuer does have a feature to update the data on the card or to perform certain actions on the card or the application post issuance of that card. Whenever an authorization is received by the issuer, that is when a cardholder uses the card in a terminal, then the issuer can initiate an issuer script update process as a part of the authorization response. This way, the issuer has a control over the card after the issuance of the card. We'll cover about how the EMV scripting process works in the next section. Now, let's look at a use case. Assume a customer loses a card, calls the bank and then blocks the card. And then the fraudster uses the card at a POS machine, and then this particular authorization reaches the issuer bank. The issuer realizes that it's a lost card, so then the issuer sends a script to permanently block the card in the authorization response to the terminal. So the terminal then passes this command to the card, and the card will get permanently blocked. In case of a magnetic stripe, this was not possible. The fraudster had an opportunity to use the card multiple times. Whereas in case of an EMV card, the card can be blocked permanently when a fraudster tries to use, and in the subsequent use, the card becomes unusable. So when is EMV scripting possible? It is possible only for online transactions. That is, when a transaction is performed and then the issuer receives that authorization for decisioning, an EMV scripting is possible. It is not possible for offline transactions. In case of an offline transactions, the transaction is never sent to the scheme. It is decided between the card and the terminal. So in which case, the issuer cannot send an issuer script back. Whereas in case of an online transaction, the transaction goes to the issuer for decisioning, and then the issuer can actually send the script as a part of the response. So issuer scripting is possible only for online transactions, and it is not possible for offline transactions. So what sort of updates that can be done via issuer scripting? Using issuer scripting, we can block the card. We can block a certain application and also unblock it. We can unblock the PIN, or we can change the PIN for an offline PIN usage, or the data that has been issued as a part of the card personalization, like the limits, etc., can be updated via the issuer scripting. Now, let's see how does EMV scripting work. So, whenever we use a particular card at a terminal, the terminal initiates an ISO 8583 request message to the issuer. Then, the issuer inserts the script that is to be executed on that particular card. In case of a MasterCard, the issuer script is inserted in data element 55, and in case of a Visa, the issuer script is updated in data element 142. So within these data elements, in tag 71 or 72, the issuer script is included. The issuer's authorization response is passed back to the terminal, and acquirer then passes the script to the card. So if the script is passed in tag 71, then the script is provided to the card before the execution of second generate AC command. If the issuer script is provided in tag 72, then the issuer script is provided after the second generate AC command. So this is how the terminal passes the script it received from the issuer, and the card will execute this issuer script. Let's look at now some key notes pertaining to issuer scripting. The issuer script in tag 71 or 72 is of 128 bytes length. So any number of commands that can be encompassed within that 128 bytes can be sent by the issuer to the terminal back. The terminal passes the commands in the order it received in the authorization response. So how does the issuer know if the issuer script was successfully executed or not? The response of a particular script update process is included in the next authorization request card verification results field, or it is also included as a part of the clearing data issuer script results field. So the issuer can know either in the subsequent authorization that the issuer would receive in the CVR field or in the clearing file. The issuer script process is generally used for DIP transactions because the card is in contact with the terminal for a longer time till the transaction completes. However, the issuer scripting process is also applicable for contactless transactions when the card is in the vicinity of that particular terminal, or the terminal will request the cardholder to present the card again if in case it found a script in the authorization response. For further reading on this topic, these are two books that I would refer. One is EMV Book 3, Application Specification. There's a separate section for issuer to card script processing, or for EMV contactless transactions, depending on the kernel that you would use, the book CN, if it is kernel 5, then refer book 5 for further specifications. Thank you for watching the video. Do like the video if you learned something new from it, and subscribe to the channel. Thank you.